So you're probably already familiar with the interface for Apple Mail. Essentially, you just have a toolbar at the very top, and then you have three panes down here, the viewing panes. So on the far left, you will see your mailboxes or different email accounts, including some folders if you've already created some. The middle list over here is your message list, and then you have the actual email message in the far right pane. So what I like to look at is how you can customize a toolbar up here. And in order to do that, you just need to find an empty spot on the toolbar and right-click or two-finger click on it, and you'll see this customized toolbar option. When you do that, you will see all these different little buttons that you can add to the toolbar. So right now I have the default set, which came with the Mac by default. And you can customize this by simply dragging some of these items up to the toolbar. So for example, if you print a lot of emails, you can grab the print button and just drag it up here. If you sometimes find the font is a little too small or too large, you can grab this icon over here and you'll have the ability to quickly change the font size, actually the whole email size. There's some other interesting ones such as the add to contact. So if you have that up here, you can, whenever you have an email message selected, you can click on this and the person who sent it to you will be automatically added to your contacts. So spend some time in here and look for things that you might want to be able to use. And another useful feature is the ability to, right now we're an icon only up here. So you have all these little icons, but if you're not sure what some of these are, you can turn that into icon and text. And now you will have a heading right below the icons letting you know where they are. So you might want to leave that on for a while till you're familiar with everything. And that's it. That is how you customize the toolbar. The second tip I have is going to allow you to reduce clutter when you're replying to email messages a bit. So for example, if I have an email, the default setting in this application is that when I reply, it's going to include the original email, all of it. And as you've probably experienced, if you have a few replies back and forth between a couple of individuals, you can end up with a very cluttered, very busy email. So there's a solution to that. If there's a specific question you have about an email, you can simply, let's say I had a question about this update of your profile area, I could simply highlight that before I hit reply. And now that's the only thing that's going to be included in my reply email, which can make it for much more clear, concise emails. So number three is about making sure that an email address is legitimate. Because unfortunately, as useful as email is, it's also one of the most effective ways for scammers to try and con people into giving them passwords or financial information online. And because of that, you always need to stay on guard when reading and replying to emails. One of the most common ways scam artists try to dupe people is by sending them emails that look like they're coming from a well-known company like Facebook, UPS, FedEx, Dropbox, and so on. So there's going to be times we need to really slow down when receiving these messages, no matter how legitimate they look. And for example, if you're receiving a delivery notification from UPS or FedEx, you're not currently expecting a shipment, you need to check if the sender's email address matches what it should look like. So I'll give you an example here. I have one that came in a couple days ago, a LinkedIn email about getting this, you know, five people looked at my name and so on. And this looks very much like the real thing. And I almost clicked on it. But if I come up here, if you look at the senders, you know, people can customize this whatever they want, but you can click on the little flippy triangle and you'll see the actual email address. And I can see that this is from an email address from upstate.edu. So it's not a LinkedIn email, but it looks very real. And if I click on it and takes me to Safari. Safari is actually already aware this is a deceptive site, and it's letting me know that this is something dangerous and don't go to the site, basically. So as a general rule, if you're unsure, make sure you come up here to the sender's email address and click on it and look at the actual email address, not just the name they've given it. All right. Number four, we're going to look at how you can clean out old email addresses from the mail application. So whenever you reply to an email or send an email in this application, it's going to store that email address for you. which is pretty useful in a sense that if you create a new message and when you start typing, it's going to autofill. It's going to give you all these options, people you've been in touch with in the past, which is cool. It can save you a lot of time, but over the course of months and years, you're going to accumulate a lot of email addresses that you will never need to use again. So you need to be able to clean this up. I've also seen a lot of instances where people had the email address typed in incorrectly and couldn't figure out why I keep sending to the wrong email address all the time. So in order to clean this up, you could come up here to the window menu and choose previous recipients. And when you open that up, you'll have this pane here and you will see all the emails that you've used in the past. And you'll see, for example, I've replied to a Craigslist ad. I will never email that person again, so I can go ahead and remove that. So you could just select it and remove this from the list. And if you go down, anybody that's actually in your contacts list, there'll be this little icon over here in the left that you can see. Anybody else is not in your contacts book. And so you should come in here, spend some time to do a little house cleaning every few months, just to keep it nice and tight in here. Number six, save in attachments. So attachments in emails can be just about anything, including documents, pictures, invoices, videos, and so on. Some of these attachments you may want to save on your computer for later use, and you can do that directly in the mail application, and you can choose where those files should go. So if you receive an email with an attachment, you can either go look for it in here. A lot of times I'll be at the bottom of the email, so in this instance, it's right down here. You can right-click on that, and then you have an option to save attachment or save it directly to the downloads folder. Another way of saving these is by going at the very top, and you'll see this little pop-up menu at the top of the email, and you'll see the little attachment icon right over here. When you click on that, you can save the attachment by clicking here, and then you'll have to decide where you want to put it. So you can save it to your downloads folder, or you could open this up with a little flippy triangle and find an area on your computer. So I want to save it to my desktop. If I do that, then it's going to be saved directly to the desktop. So that's how you save attachments in mail. Number seven, we're going to look at shortcuts for moving emails to specific folders. So as you probably already know, when you get emails, you can save these to folders you create on your computer or in one of your cloud services. And you can just simply drag and drop these anywhere you choose. You could also right-click on that email, and you'll have the option down here to move that email to, again, same thing, these specific folders. Or you can copy the email to a folder. Now, the nice thing in mail is that it's going to remember if you regularly receive emails from the same people or companies and save them to a specific folder, it's going to remember that behavior. And so let's say that I click here and right click, it knows that I've been moving it to the Skillshare folder every time, or the one above it, Mike Monday. I get a lot of emails from him. I always move him to Mike Monday. So instead of having to drag and drop every time or move and find a folder every time, after it's going to learn your behavior. After you move a specific person to the same folder and over again, you're going to get this option over here, which can be a big time saver. Number eight, selecting the default email account when you're sending a new message. So when you create a new message in mail, and if you have more than one email address set up in mail, it's going to pick out for you which address it thinks you want to use. So you'll notice if I go to new message up there right now, it's coming from this mac.com, which is an iCloud address I've had for years. And the reason it's picking that over the other email addresses I have in here is because right now I have an email selected that was addressed to my iCloud account. If I have this one selected, which was addressed to my Gmail account, and now I come up to new message, you'll notice that it's the Gmail address that's picked out. So that usually is fine with in most cases, but for some people, you always want to send out all your emails from one address and one address only, and you can set that up in the preferences. So you could come up here and go to preferences, and it's under the composing tab that you'll find under the addressing area here, that when you send a new message from, it's right now it's selected to automatically select the best account. but I could come here and pick one out. So I could choose, let's say, my MacLearn account as the email address I always send out new emails from. So that's a useful little tip. Number 9, the stationary browser. So this is a fun little feature. Once in a while, you may want to jazz up an email with something other than just a regular old boring white background. And you can do that really easily in Mail by using the stationary browser. So the stationary pane button is right up here in the very top right. When you click on that, you will see these different stylized email templates that you can use and customize with your own text and images. So you have these different categories over here: birthday, announcements, photos, stationery, sentiments. And you can just click on these to see what they look like. And announcements has quite a few up here. So lunch invite and formal invite and so on. So if you want to use one of these, you can click on it. And then you can just click inside the text area and type in your own text. And hopefully you'll get cookies. If you want to use one of the photos ones, let's choose this bamboo or airmail right over here. You can drag and drop your own images in these placeholders. So you could come up here, click on the photo browser icon. And when that opens up, maybe I didn't click on that properly. Here we go. All right. So you can then drag and drop your own images right into these placeholders like this. And I'll do a couple more. Yep. It can sometimes go a little slow. There we go. And one more. And I now have some images right in this email. And I can type in my own text. If I could type well, that'd be better. All right, so you get the drift. You can customize these however you want. And whenever you're ready to send, keep an eye out on this size over here. And sometimes they'll give you a really high image count or a high megabyte size. And then after a while, it will go down in size. But this shouldn't be too much of an issue. It usually, before it sends it out, it'll make sure that the images are not too big. And then number 10, finally, we will look at how you can change the size of these icons and folder in this left side pane over here. So if you want to shrink these or make them a little bigger, you can do so. But it's not going to be a preference inside of Mail. It's actually a global preference inside of System Preferences and then General. And here you have a sidebar icon size option. So you'll notice when I choose small that these will change and get a little bit smaller, or you can make them a little bit larger. So I'm going to put it back down to medium. But you should be aware that if you do this, it's going to change not only in Mail, but also in other areas on the computer. So your Finder icons will also change. And you'll see what I mean. If I change that same setting here, it's going to make him a lot bigger over here. So it's up to you. Experiment with that. But with some of these displays that are really where everything's really quite small, it's nice sometimes to be able to bump it up a little bit. All right. So that wraps it up for the whole session on Mail.